Hi, this is Frank Taylor with Nature at Your Door. Today, I'm a couple hundred yards from my door, down here in near this stream and a little hollow in the woods near my house. This is a great place to look for salamanders. And I'm really excited because today I found a salamander. And it's a different species than any of the ones that I've shown before on my channel. The name of this amphibian is the Northern Dusky Salamander, Desmoganthus fuscus. And today's episode is gonna be on where you can find them, how I found this one, and a little bit about their biology and natural history. So stay tuned. Right here in your backyard, you never know what you're gonna find. And here's to make this invasive. It's exotic. Dogwoods are flowering. And I just took a couple swipes terrestrial environment.
Produce seed pollen. And it's...
Northern duskies have this kind of very stout body and a keeled tail, which they use because they live near water and primarily hunt in the water. From the scientific name, Desmoganthus fucus, fucus means dusky. And they're sort of brown and gray. They have a white belly with black and white speckles. And usually there's a little mark here from the eye back to the jawline. Another way biologists identify different species of salamanders is by counting the coastal grooves. And the coastal grooves kind of look like ribs on the side of the salamander. This particular species has 14 if you get a chance to hold them, because this is definitely a wriggly salamander that likes to try to escape. The scientific name, Desmoganthus, and I hope I'm saying it right, comes from the Latin words that mean desmo means ligament, ganthus means jaw, and they refer to the big jaw ligaments that seem to be apparent if you look at his head in cross-section. These salamanders have a very broad range. You can find them from Maine to Florida and west to Louisiana. But it doesn't mean you'll find them everywhere. They live in very particular isolated places where they have very specific habitat requirements in order to live. One of the reasons they're very habitat specific is because, like other members of this group, the Northern Dusky Salamander is lungless. Yeah, it doesn't have any lungs, and it lives a lot of its life on land. And it gets its oxygen through its skin and membranes in its mouth and its throat. So in order to do that, it is critical that it keeps its skin moist. So the only place you're going to find dusky salamanders is near water. In the Appalachian Mountains, they like to be near running streams where water is babbling over rocks. They like to have a lot of flat rocks close to the stream that they can hide under, and they like that water cool. So on a conservation level, if that water gets polluted or the land is developed and the trees are cut down and it's exposed to drying, the dusky salamanders will disappear from that area. Dusky salamanders are preyed upon by both birds, mammals, reptiles, and other amphibians. And unlike some of the other salamanders, they don't have a whole lot of toxic skin secretions. So they rely on being nocturnal and hiding as much as they can to avoid predation, like this one is always doing. So this guy is different from the red F stage of the newt that I've shown you before, that walks around with impunity, advertising its bright orangeness and toxicity. You'll often find the red F stage walking across the ground, while the dusky salamander, you're gonna find him under rocks. A couple really fascinating things about the dusky salamander is they have a very limited home range. A dusky salamander is gonna live in an area its whole life about a square meter or two. On the average, their home range is around 1.5 square meters or square yards. Another interesting thing is while they're very tied with water and they most of their food comes from the water, eating small invertebrates and anything wriggling in the water that it can catch. And it lays its eggs on land, under a flat rock or under a log. And the mother will stay with the eggs and defend them. And there are some reports that even the larva will stay close to the mother for several weeks after they've hatched. These guys, I promise you, move with great agility. I had to move quick to grab him. He's very slippery and he's a Houdini escape artist. And surprisingly, they're really good jumpers too. And you usually don't think of the salamander as a good jumper, but they'll do anything to escape and hide. I tried to be very, very cautious in the limited time that I handled him, because this species of salamander, like other salamanders and some lizards, will break off their tail spontaneously to distract the predator. So they'll sacrifice a huge part of their body in order to escape. And I really didn't want to bother him so much that that would happen. And so far I've been successful. Like I told you, I love looking for salamanders, and here in the Appalachian Mountains, we have more species of salamanders than probably anywhere else in the world. And when I look for them, I always look under logs or flat rocks, but I always, always, always make an extra effort to put the rock or log back exactly as I found it, and return the organism if I do in fact pick them up. I wet my hands first, because their skin is very sensitive. And it's actually also really important that if you're planning to look for salamanders, to wash your hands thoroughly of any ointments, gels, hand lotions, anything that you might have on there, and rinse them off in clean water. Because in fact, some of those things could be toxic to a sensitive salamander as well. So always, always wet your hands first. Have hands clean of detergents, and replace the rock or log that you turn over exactly in the same place. So this salamander I have is going to be returned to the exact spot that I found him, which was right here. So this final clip you're looking at is actually a couple weeks later after I shot the initial part of the video. And if you look real quick, you can see that there's the dusky. There he is. This is where he lives. This is where his home range is. So it's pretty cool. Every couple weeks, I go check up on him. This is his range. This is where he lives. And I always put that piece of metal back exactly where I found it. Well, thanks for watching today's episode of Nature at Your Door. I hope you enjoyed it. And if you do like what I do, please subscribe to my channel and check out my other videos. I'm getting together quite a library now. You can even binge watch my channel. And remember, I love sharing with you, but I also really love hearing from you. Please leave me comments. Let me know how I'm doing. Let me know what you liked about the video and ask me questions. I'll get back to you as soon as I can. Up until now, I have answered every single question or comment that has come in on my video. So I'm looking forward to hear from you too. And remember, I'm just watching to see what happens, what comes out, what flowers near my house, what animals walk by or what I stumble into, and I'll share them with you because I think you're gonna find the same things too. And I love telling the stories of these organisms. Thank you for watching Nature at Your Door. See you at the next episode.